I'm alone. Anyway. Brent is out already. He's going to be on the other vehicle this morning. And then Steph's back this morning too, or a little bit later for the bushwalk, which is nice. What else? It's a cool overcast morning. The joys of dealing with our comms issues daily. Oh, it's interesting. It's interesting, but I suppose if you're out in the bush, that's what happens. I think Gendre is just getting another radio. Genre is back. It's tough when I'm by myself and I've just got to speak to I suppose I've got everybody watching, or most people watching already. Quack, quack, great go away birds. Shall we do a test there quickly? Please, Jerry. Yes. Oh no. Nothing yet. Yeah, me by myself. Still nothing, Jondre. No, we still seem to be having issues with our comms, unfortunately, for Gendre. Hi, Steph.
Hi. Hi, Gendre. Can you hear me yet? Gendre. Morning, Steph.
Did you get that? Yeah. Do a quick test there, please, Jerry. Are we good? Okay, perfect. I think we sorted now with the comms issue. Yeah, it looks like. Chandra's camera checks have been done. Do I need to clap, Jerry? Don't I need to clap and? No, I didn't clap. That was Brent. Doing a mic test and a sync test so that you can all hear me. All right, let's go. We're ready, Gendre. I think Brent's looking for lions this morning. I'm going to look for anything, really. Weather this morning 22 and 71, but I think Brent might tell you that again at the official start of the show. 22 degrees Celsius, nice and cool, not too bad, not too hot. It was quite hot last night though, very muggy. Hoping to get some rain, and it's threatening. It's cloud cover in the mornings, and then what's been happening, cloud cover burns off, and then we get these rain threats. I say threatening rain. It looks like the clouds are building. It looks like it's going to rain, just like it did yesterday. And then nothing, no rain. So hopefully it keeps building, and perhaps soon we'll have some rain. All right, goodbye everybody. Well, for now, for the pre-show show. We'll see you all shortly. Brent's going to start the show. We'll chat to you later.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Welcome to the middle of the African bush. We're on a fresh set of male lion tracks. Hopefully we find them soon. This is Safari Live.
Ready?
Morning, morning, and welcome to the middle of the African bush. Oh, I'm attached at the ear. Now, there's two male lions walked past quarantine. They've come down into Philemon's Dip. We're trying to figure out where they've gone from there. We've lost the tracks, and sometimes they cut through towards the old hyena den. So I'm just having a quick look for some fresh tracks here. Hopefully the bushes don't growl at me. Now, we are 100% live from the middle of the African bush. You can also ask us questions by using the hashtag SafariLive or the email address questions@wildearth.tv. Now, it doesn't look like the lions went this way, so we're going to go down and check where the last tracks went. Now, it's a warm morning. As you can see, I'm still in my short pants. It's about 22 degrees Celsius, 72 Fahrenheit, but it is quite overcast and cloudy. But I don't think it's going to rain just yet. It's been threatening, and according to the weather forecast, which I don't ever trust, we're supposed to have an absolute deluge come Friday, Saturday, Sunday. There is 120 millimeters predicted. If that's the case, we shall not be going on game drives, we shall be going on game swims. Might have to do some serious frogging. B. Wilson, welcome, welcome. B. Wilson's wondering if it rained last night. It did not. And I think it's building, building, building. We will see if the South African weather services have got it right. They've issued flood warnings for the weekend. And as I said, we might be freestyling through the African bush or batten down the hatches and stay in the tent. We're going to have to see what happens. I never know with weather. It's one of those ones. I'll tell you when it's raining, when it's raining. So the last tracks were in this little dip here, which is known as Philemon's Dip. It's also the water pump that puts water in our showers. Okay, I'm just gonna have a quick look. Now, we definitely had tracks just up ahead. Now, did they disappear into the bush and follow the drainage line, or did they cut through to the west? So there were at least two of them from the track I could see. I wonder if they went down this little sneaky road here. Okay, I'm Byron. Where am I going to go next? I'm going to stop over here. Yes, I'm going to stop over here. I'm going to scent mark quickly. I'm going to keep going because I'm the biggest, toughest cat in the bush. And where do I go from here? I know, I'm going to confuse Brent and I'm going to go this way. Or not. Or do I? Now, quite often when you're tracking, especially when the animals leave the road, we've got to do a bit of guessing. Educated guessing is probably the better description. And I've still got tracks right here and there. So maybe they went straight past the pump house. Let's go check further down Philemon's cut line. I did hear them roaring when I woke up this morning. It sounded like they were down south somewhere. Maybe, I didn't think they was far west, but maybe they've been moving constantly. So let's keep up. Of course, if we have no luck with these big boys, we're always gonna go check on Nkuhuma Pride, who I think probably haven't moved too far from that buffalo kill they made yesterday. While I keep on the lion tracks, hopefully we'll be blessed with some big cats shortly. Let's go see what Byron's plan for the morning is.
Good morning, everybody. My name's Byron, and with me on camera this morning is Jandre. and I am currently looking for the Nkuhuma pride. I've come into the area where they were last seen yesterday, but it doesn't seem as if there's any sign of them just yet. Looking very, very carefully, we're not where the carcass was that they had yesterday. When they were, they actually left that carcass. Apparently there was nothing left of it. So just having a look around here to see if we can find them. But usually what happens with lions after they feed and they finish a carcass, they'll probably head towards some water. The reason for that is because they get very, very thirsty. The blood of a lot of animals, and especially buffalo and that they're feeding on, it's very salty, so generally they do look for water after feeding. But I'm sure we'll have some luck a little bit later. We're going to drive around, see if we can't find some tracks. But it doesn't appear as if they are in this block anymore where they were yesterday. So they have moved off. Nice cool morning, so I'm sure if these lions are moving around, they could potentially be moving for quite some time this morning in this cool weather. They don't, you know, we know lions generally don't like to move too much during the heat of the day when it is very, very warm. Conserve the energy rather for when it's cooler and for the evenings. That's when lions do move around a lot. However, saying that, we've seen in the past, lions are very opportunistic, and if there's food around, something that they'd like to potentially hunt, even if it's hot, they will still hunt. And this Nkuhuma pride actually did it a few weeks ago, two, three weeks ago. One afternoon, about 4:30, 5 o'clock in the afternoon, they got up and they hunted the buffalo close to some water. And that is unusual, but it does happen. I think let's take Aubrey's up here to see if they're on tracks of these lions coming out anywhere. What we'll do is we'll do a big loop around this area and see if they are potentially still in the block, or if they have moved, which direction they've moved to. Like I say, maybe towards water. So what I think I might do is head towards that Gallagher waterhole, that small little pan, and just go and have a look around there. But I want to scan very, very carefully in this area. Are some lion tracks here, everyone, and they are heading, it appears as if the fresh tracks are heading in this direction. And Dubrat Dave would like to know, where's the main water source in Djuma? So at the moment, I would say one of the main water sources is probably the Djuma Dam. That's the largest, I think, dam around at the moment. So that would be the main water source on Djuma, where we are. So having a look, these lions have walked all along here. And these tracks do look fresh from this morning sometime, perhaps, or last night. Nothing's driven over them or walked on top of them. Yep. The lions walked all along the road here, which is nice. Very kind of them to walk along the road. And again, they use the roads because it's a large pathway. It's easier for them to move through the bush on these roads. They don't need to dodge bushes or walk through long grass. Still seeing little tracks, and it looks like little tracks of the cubs too. I just want to double check and make sure. Yep, I can definitely see lioness and cub tracks. Alright, so while we follow these tracks, let's head back to Brent and see how he's doing with those male lion tracks.
Thank you.
We're doing some more educated guessing. Now, from the audio I heard early this morning, they were heading south. So fingers crossed they haven't quite made it to the southern boundary yet. But to ensure they haven't, VM and I are going to go down the southern boundary, see if we find anything there. Also, good chance to check for Queen Karula, see if she went south with Hosana and Shongile. I've got a strong feeling she's probably left the cubs sleeping in the area where they had that kill yesterday, but you never know. So we'll have to check there while we're down on the southern end of Djuma. Okay, we're on the southern boundary. We're going to be checking carefully for all sorts of tracks. And of course I have, of the camera department, the best track spotter with me, and that's VM, of course. He's like an extra tracker, so always good. VM's going to keep a look on the left, I'm going to keep a look on the right. Morning for birding with a camera. Good morning, Mary in Texas. Says, was there a Philemon that road was named after? Yes, Philemon worked at Djuma for many, many years. He has now moved to the Djuma in the sky quite some time ago, though, long before Wild Earth arrived here. But yes, he used to maintain the roads and such and such. Oh, what have we got here? No lion tracks, no leopard tracks just yet. Now, sometimes this road can be quite difficult for tracks because it is one of the main access roads, so I'm going so slowly because there is quite a lot of traffic on all hours down this road. So far, hippo tracks, and not much else, apart from impalas. Now, coming up ahead is one of Karula's favorite spots to cross, so we're going to be checking there very carefully. Some buffalo tracks around, nothing particularly fresh so far. We do spend quite a lot of time checking this road. Especially because Karula's territory sort of falls on either side of this road. So it is an area we spend a lot of time. Okay, now this is where we've got to check very, very carefully. Like most lions and leopards like to utilize roads. They like nice big animal paths for them. Okay. Now, male lion tracks, a lot easier to see. They're about the size of my hand. Karula's tracks, about this big. So you've got to look far more carefully for the Queen of Djuma's tracks than you do for the Birmingham boys. Nope. Good sign. Okay, some elephants around here overnight, but quite early on there's lots of little nocturnal critters, millipedes and the such, with the tracks that are on top. So another spot to look for Karula tracks that she comes through quite often. Nothing so far. Looking good, looking good. Safari Live on Twitter, or questions at wildearth.tv if you would like to ask us any questions about what we're up to or anything out here in Africa. Now, since we're tracking away here, I think it's time to get your grey matter working. And it is a quiz we've done before, but I think there's quite a lot of new viewers who might not know. So my favorite antelope family are the Traphelagids, or the spiral horned antelope, and we get a few of them here, but I'm going to ask you, how many spiral horned antelope are there in the whole of Africa? So spiral horned, I'll give you one to start off with. Cuckoo is a spiral horned antelope. So how many Traphelagids are there in the whole of Africa? Send your answers through to questions at wildearth.tv or hashtag Safari Live, and get that grey matter a churning on this sunrise safari. Nothing so far. Where have these lions disappeared to? Well, if we don't see tracks, as I said, it's quite a good sign. It means they're still within our traverse area. More buffalo tracks. It doesn't look like they're running from lion tracks though. They just look like I'm ambling along tracks. Now there's another big road junction up ahead, which is also quite a popular spot for lions and things to cross, particularly the Birmingham boys. They tend to walk that route, but we just wanted to make sure that there was nothing crossing up this side. Now, of course, there's still a few firsts for the wet season to find. The first baby warthogs, the first baby wildebeest, the first pygmy kingfisher, the first European oriole, European golden oriole, sorry. Now, Virginia's wondering, is it easier for me to spot the tracks now that I don't have a door? Well, it is, Virginia, particularly when I drive like this. You can use the steering wheel. Oh, that looked like tracks. Stop being silly, dear Smith. What track was that? Well, thank goodness it was only a baboon. Okay, so if the lions have crossed out of Djuma, the most likely spot is about 50 meters up ahead. Jay is wondering about lion versus leopard tracks. How do you tell the difference? Well, lion tracks are generally quite easy. I mean, a male lion is the size of my hand. A male leopard is probably only the size, more size of the inside of my palm, and that's a very big male. Now, when it comes to... Oh, no. That's Karula and the cubs, by the looks of things. Jay, I'll get back to your question now. Okay, so why I say it looks like Karula and the cubs, there's one track, there's another track that looks like Karula, and that looks like Hassana. Their tracks are pretty much, as we would say in Swahili, kama kawaida, same difference. Now I'm sure if we looked a little bit more carefully, Shongile's tracks will be around here somewhere as well. Okay, well, unfortunately the royal family has gone back down to the south. We will keep a lookout and an ear out to see if they come back to the west. Hopefully we don't find any lion tracks on this road, and that means we'll go back and start at last tracks again. Okay, so we've got some answers into the quiz, and two different ones. We've got 9 and 7 species. Fuzzman Sparkle says 9, and CC and Aaron say 7. Now, oh, there's Shongile. No, that's good. Oh, that's bad. Oh, it's old. That's good.
I don't see more. Just one sticking out.
I actually tracked that one the other day. Okay, so let's run through them together. There are 5 in Southern Africa. And of course, I should have clarified, we're not doing subspecies and things that are sort of not negotiated, but argued by geneticists and stuff like that, till they're classified as a species on there and they don't count. So we've got 5 in Southern Africa: Kudu, Inyala, Bushbuck, Eland. Vim, can you tell me the last one? Vim wasn't listening, it seems like. So we've got Kudu, Inyala, Bushbuck, and Eland. And the last one is?
Congo.
No, in Southern Africa. Sitatunga. So a Sitatunga, and look at that. Here is some spiral horned antelope while we're speaking about them. So there's 5 in Southern Africa. And of course, let's try to get a better view there. And VM's mentioned another one, Bongo, from West and Central Africa. Now, again, the Bongo is argue that there's 2 species, the East African bongo and the West, but genetically there's not that much difference in them just yet. Hello, little boy. Okay, so we got bongo, and then we have Lesser Kudu, we have Lord Derby's Eland, and we have Mountain Inyala. So there we go, a very well done to Fuzzman Sparkles, indeed 9 different species of Traphylagids. Now, these little boys, they haven't quite developed their large curl that of a horn. They've just got little horns, but they're growing up quickly, and they're going to grow up nice and quickly if they keep eating that round leaf teak, nice and nutritious. Oh, and the rain tree. But while we continue our search for the big male lions that so far look like they have not left Djuma, and let's go see how Byron's tracking of the Nkuhumas is going.
So no luck just yet on our tracks either. Done a big loop around, and I think these lions may still be in this block off to my left. But let's have a look. What's that on the left there? Jandre, is there something down there? Nothing, eh? Antelope tracks. So I'm trying to listen out for any alarm calls. Maybe we're lucky and something spots the lions for us and lets us know where they are, more or less. But nothing yet. And so far we've only managed to see 1 impala. I had a look for a little lamb, but no sign. I'd love to see. I can't wait to see my first little lamb of the season. There's a big male. There we go. Speaking of impala. Big male. Oh, he's just running off through the bushes. Can you see him through there? Disappearing on us. The lone male, and that's interesting. Possibly just a territorial male that was in a nice open area. So I'm assuming you would have just stayed here for safety. Nice and open. Possibly some other impala around here earlier. Just having a careful look. It's always difficult to drive and track at the same time, I find. I do think we miss a lot of the tracks. If we are driving and we don't necessarily have a tracker with us, it does help sitting on the front of the vehicle while you are driving. It just makes it a lot easier. Also, you know, the guide generally, while he's interpreting the bush to guests and turning around and chatting to the guests, he might miss something up front. And it does help to have a tracker with you who's able to keep an eye out for any tracks or signs of animals crossing the road. Dina, you wanted to know if we are the first vehicles out every morning, Wild Earth, and it sounds like it this morning, definitely. We were the first ones out, and I think we are generally the first ones out, because I'm trying to think. I think most lodges, if I'm not mistaken, most lodges do a wake up around 5 a.m., and the guests meet on deck at 5:30 or meet in the car park where the vehicles are at about 5:30, and they head out on drive, maybe with a cup of coffee and a biscuit first. Oh, some zebra. Wonderful. Hang on. Just try to look for a little gap here. Oh, beautiful, some zebra. I'm just trying to see if there's another little gap. Chandra, maybe if I move forward a little bit for you, I might get a better view of them. They seem quite relaxed with us, which is good. Yeah, here we go. We'll get a lovely view of them from here. How's that? Isn't that a bit better? Oh, always great seeing some zebra. A dazzle of zebra, and I think it's a very appropriate name for a group of zebra, a dazzle. Dana, you wanted to know if the zebras actually lie down flat when they do sleep, and they do sometimes, Dana, they will lie down, and I've seen it especially with zebra foals. The young zebra do lie down, they lie completely flat when they are sleeping, but we need to remember a lot of these animals don't necessarily lie down for long periods of time, but I have seen adult zebras lying down and resting, maybe for a few minutes, half an hour, and then they generally get up and move again, because when they are lying down, they are obviously vulnerable to any predators if there are any around. So most of these animals, even though they lie down and rest, it will be for a very short period of time, and there will most likely be a number of other zebra around, for example, that are keeping a close eye out for any danger or any predators. Some Cape turtle doves calling in the distance. It's a lovely morning, and those tails constantly swishing of the zebra keeping the flies away. And it's wonderful if you can. Sometimes you can see the zebra, what they do is they stand head to tail and they flick their tail backwards and forwards to keep the basically to keep the flies out of each other's faces. Now, Adam, you wanted to know how tall the zebra are at the shoulder. Good question. I'll have to see if I can find out. I would say they're probably about 130 centimeters or so. Let's have a look quickly, Adam. Let me try to find out for you. Let's see what they say. Yeah, 1.3 meters tall at the shoulder. Sure, how's that for a guess? So 1.3 meters tall. Sometimes some species may get to about 1.5 centimeters, but generally the plain zebra or the Birchall zebra, which is the species of zebra that we are seeing right now, is about 1.3 to 1.4 meters at the shoulder. Some wonderful stripes. They are beautiful, beautiful animals. Some interesting historical pictures of zebra in Africa. Now we've learned apparently that studies have been done that, well, for one, you can't really tame zebra or use them for anything, so farmers and that wouldn't have used zebra for work animals on farmlands and that, and apparently you cannot really ride a zebra. I've never tried, but their backs are much weaker than horses, so it wouldn't make sense to try and use them for that. But there are some wonderful historic pictures of zebra or subspecies of zebra pulling a cart with somebody riding the cart and obviously having the zebra much like a horse-drawn cart and having the zebra pull the wagon or the cart, which is interesting. But that would have been maybe 80 to 100 years ago. And there they go. Rena, you want to know if there's only one species of zebra? No, Rena, there are many more. Now, in southern Africa, we've got... let me make sure I get this right. I think we've just got the three species. So we've got these Birchall zebra, or the plains zebra, which we see in this area. So in the Greater Kruger, this northeastern part of South Africa, that is the only species we get here. However, down in the southern part of South Africa, so in the Karoo, we call it, closer down to the southern coast of South Africa, we've got a species known as the Cape Mountain zebra. So it's a different species, a subspecies of zebra down there. And then up to the western side of South Africa too, west and northwest, we've got a species called the Hartman Mountain zebra. And let me see if I can find you some pictures of the different species. And all that's really different, all the subspecies, and all that's different is the shape, or is the pattern and the stripes on those zebra. And I'll show you here quickly. There we go. So this image over here has got the Cape Mountain zebra and the Hartman zebra on the top. And what we can see is, you see how narrow those stripes are, very, very close together. And notice how the stripes stop just before they get to the bottom of the belly, and the belly is completely white and very much similar to the Hartman zebra. That's Hartman zebra at the bottom, Hartman's Mountain zebra. And they're called Mountain zebra because they do climb mountains very, very well. And then at the bottom is the Plains zebra, used to be known as the Birchall's zebra. So the Plains zebra and these zebra, you can see there's a very distinct difference in the size of the stripes, much wider apart. And you might also get a slight shadow stripe, which they refer to, between the black and the white stripes, that little shadow stripe moving through there. And also the stripes extend right around the belly, so not completely white. And then there are other zebra species up in East Africa. Grevy's zebra. Grevy's zebra. What else? Now I'm trying to think. Brent might know better which other species are up there. Because Brent did work up in East Africa for a short while. And speaking of Brent, let's head over to him now. See how he's doing with those lions. I wonder if he's found them yet.
Well, it seems like our lion tracking has come to fruition. And here we go. The two males that we've been tracking all morning, we've found them on Twin Dams. So it's Mfumo, the authority. You can see how well his little... Well, it's now a little, but at one point, his massive hole in the face. Oh, and I think that's Tinyo. I haven't seen decently yet because he's been snoozing, but it looks to be Tinyo. So there we go, two members of the Birmingham Coalition. Oh, bless you. Did you suck in a little bit too much dust there, but here we go. It looks like Tinyo, the tooth. You can see, yeah, I can see that remnant of a split lip just there as he turned. Now, it's quite interesting when we look at both of them here. Now, you can see Tinyo's mane is darkening faster. You can see underneath getting really nice and dark. I'm just going to move the vehicle a little bit so we got a good view of both of them. Now that Tinyo has decided to raise his head. We want to see the left-hand side of your face. Stop turning your head. I know you're watching my tires. Yep, it is definitely Tinyo. I'm happy with that now. We know who they are. Now, boys, it's very important. We want roaring this morning. And you've been roaring all morning. I heard you from about 4 o'clock making lots of noise. Now you need to make some noise for us. Looking quite well fed. Three of them were seen together yesterday in Buffheshoek. So these two plus one of the other, Nena or Utsuku. But I haven't seen either of those for quite some time. Big boys. So now this is a perfect, perfect eyes, look at that. Stare straight through you. Now, you can see the battle scars that litter a male lion. And as I was saying, you can now see his mane quite clearly. See how it's much, much darker underneath. There we go, then Mfumo's. And he's getting that lovely little, sus. Let's do some grooming. Definitely, you can see that also that dark mohawk starting to form right in the center. And Mfumo is getting there. He might be a little bit younger. Now, we don't exactly know the exact ages of all the Birmingham boys, so the coalition has got different ages in it. And he could just be, Tinyo could be a little bit older, judging from how dark his mane is and also just how tattered his ears are and stuff in comparison to Mfumo. He's still quite blonde. He is getting that little... There he is, he has a little nick out of the ear. And he's still very battle-scarred. And there we go. You see, he's just looking a little bit more ragged than... Mfumo. Now, David was wondering who's older, and I'd say there's not much difference between them, maybe a year at most, but Tinyo definitely looks to be the older of the two. Now, they're looking to the south, which is bad for us. We want them to look to the north. We want them to hear some commotion that brings them deeper into Djuma. We're only about 150 meters, 200 meters away from our southern boundary. And I'm very, very happy we didn't find any lion tracks there and we found these two beautiful boys. Now, they've walked quite far from where they were yesterday in Buffheshoek. They've gone from very close to the Kruger boundary. They've headed north. I'm guessing they must have come through around Gowrie Cutline. We found their tracks on quarantine. So they've probably done a good 10 kilometers to 12 kilometers last night. And they're probably going to rest up. There's always a possibility they might get up and move a bit further to the south, but for now, it looks like they're going to rest up. Now, it looks like they might have been having a scrap quite recently. There we go. There's some fresh sort of punctures. Oh, and you can see on his foot there, it looks like a bit of blood. Yeah, there's a little red dot there. A little bit to the left. See, it looks like some fresh blood there. And there's some... looks like a fresh scratch a little bit higher and some puncture marks. Now, this is not uncommon. Male lions are always boxing with something, each other or, of course, the females or even some marauders, but more than likely each other. Oh, isn't that wonderful how well that's healed? But if we go down to his nose, he's obviously tired of smelling himself and he's smelling a little wild aniseed. So he's inhaling the licorice. Look at that. Remember, this is 100% live, so we never know what's going to happen next. They are snoozing currently, but they might jump into action. I'm really hoping that they give us a big roar. You can see they're both looking very well fed. Big bellies. And he has managed to urinate all over himself. That's not uncommon with male lions. They just sort of lie there and urinate. They're not too worried with personal hygiene. Yeah, Tinyo using his foot as a pillow. Hi, Brandon, who's in Rhode Island, who's wondering how long the Birmingham Coalition has been in power. Now, the first sort of serious pushing they did of the Matimbas, if I remember correctly, was October last year. And I'd say probably by January, February, they were in full reign, even though they hadn't quite managed to subjugate all the females in the area. Oh, yes. Life's tough. So, about 7-8 months now, probably closer to 8 months, that they've been the top coalition in the area. Now, as I said, they're probably about 6 years old, around six, between six and seven, which means unless another big coalition of males comes in, they're looking probably to sit on the top for the next 3 years or so, probably even about 4 years on the top. That's quite normal. What did you hear, mister? What did you smell? Oh, nothing that interesting. Oh, head down. Of course, there used to be five of them. The one that was known as Tsotsi or Skabanga or Scrapper, it's lots of different names. He expired due to a wound caused from a buffalo hunt. Now, lion genetics are quite an interesting thing, and they are very, very varied. And okay, so we'll get back to genetics now. We're just going to answer a question quickly from Marion, who's, it's a double header, and it's, how do coalitions form and how long do they last? Now, how they form, there's a couple of ways that they form. The most common way is that a group of related males, possibly brothers or half-brothers, of a similar age will leave their natal or home pride together. Now, of course, moving out in a group gives them a better chance of survival than heading out singly. The other way, which is also quite common, is that you might get two related males who will move out of an area, and then they, during their nomadic phase, they might bump into two unrelated males or one unrelated male, and then they join up because there's strength in numbers. Now, particularly in this part of the Kruger Park and South Africa, you get very big coalitions. And if we just go through the coalitions and the size they started at, you had the Mapohos, there were six, and the Majingalans, five. I think the Sand River males down south, there's four of them. And now we've got originally five Birminghams. The Salati males were originally four or five as well. Now, that's because there's such competition between the coalitions here for females, for breeding rights, for territory, that a single male will find it very difficult to survive. Oh, Matimbas, I nearly forgot, were originally five as well. Now, what happens sometimes is coalitions over time might split, to answer the second part of your question, Marion. Normally, they'll stay together as long as possible till they are killed by normally other lions. But so generally, the coalition will probably form when the animals are three to four years old, and they'll last till they die, so 12 years old. Now, of course, in certain circumstances, animals die quite young, like Scrapper did. He died before he was 6 years old and due to a wound from a buffalo. So there's no sort of hard and fast rule about how long coalitions will survive, but I'd say generally once they're in power, 4 to 5 years is a good sort of estimate of how long these coalitions will survive. Now, I was going to start chatting about genetics in lions. Now, originally, I think there were 37 subspecies named. Now, these have all been broken down, brought down. There are only two distinct subspecies, and that is the African lion and the Asiatic lion. The Asiatic lion lives in India. Now, if we go, let's stick on the African lions for now. You've got Western clade and Eastern clade lions, which is quite interesting. So almost down the middle of Africa, you've got two different clades that are slightly genetically different, but nothing near enough to call them a different species. And they cross over in a couple of spots, but if you look carefully, it's actually fascinating. So Kruger lions and Tanzanian lions are quite closely related. Botswana, because it's in the middle, is related to both. So it's a fascinating thing if you look at the genetics. And I've been fortunate enough to work on one of the big genetic lion projects with a non-profit organization called the African, I'm trying to remember the acronym now, APCRO, the African Predator Conservation Research Organization. And that is run by a very good friend of my dad's, a guy by the name of Dr. Mike Briggs. And he's one of the leading experts on lion genetics in the world. And he is the one who taught me all about clades and where the different lions come from. And just racking my brain for a bit more information. It's been a while since I read all those papers, but I'm sure I'll remember. Now, of course, a lot of the genetic stuff is that you've got these Kalahari lions or Cape lions that are extinct, and Barbary lions. Oh, Woodlands! We'll see if we can find him just now. But now, with being able to test the museum sort of taxidermy samples and things like that, there's almost no difference. You will find lions in desert areas tend to develop much bigger manes, and the reason for that is the climate they're in, and that's to protect them from the sandstorms and from the heat. It's not so much because they're a different species. Here we go. This is what I was thinking about. So, for example, quite interesting, West African lions, which are up in the Sahel region, so Chad and Sudan going up that side, are actually more closely related to the Asiatic lion than they are to sub-Saharan lions, to the South and East African lions, which probably means that the Asiatic lions, during the last land bridge between Africa and Asia, moved through from that area, which makes sense. It's closest to the land bridge. Massive dinner plate feet, a nice full belly. Now, Big Blue's wondering whether wild lions have dew claws like domestic cats. Indeed, they do. Let's see if we can find one. Trying to find out. Sorry, there's a bit listening. There's an update on Karula. I was just listening to the radio. That sounds like they might have found it down in the south. But let's carry on chatting about lions. And so generally, the way they, without mitochondrial DNA, the way they separate species is from skull morphology. So slight differences in the skull, and it has to be present in more than sort of 80% of the skulls modified for it to actually go through, or not modified, examined for it to go through. So it is amazing that Tsavo lions, for example, in Kenya, are far more closely related to Kruger lions than lions on the western side of Kenya. Now, the clade system is separated by the Great Rift Valley. Now, in East Africa, the Great Rift Valley is very, very obvious. Out here in South Africa, it's not so obvious, but there is a fault line that runs all the way from Kenya down through South Africa. We're on the eastern side of that fault line at the moment, and it goes out to sea in Lake St. Lucia in northern Zululand. So it is incredible if you look at the geology underneath. And of course, at certain times, maybe the Great Rift Valley was far more of an insurpassable, or more difficult to pass than it is now, and that's what separated these lions 100,000 years ago. So now there is also the middle, they're not called a clade, but they're just called the middle lions, which seem to be a combination of both western and eastern clade lions, and those occur sort of through central Zambia and into Botswana. Very interestingly, has both clades and the middle clade, so it's got all three. Now, of course, they can still all interbreed, and they haven't been separated for long enough to even close become a distinct species. Lovely bird calling and giving us the ambient sounds. We've got that, which is an orange-breasted bushrike. We heard the chirr of a Woodland Kingfisher. What else can we hear? Oh, there we go. Definitely Tinyo. You can see that wound. And here, the Valence Cuckoo as well. Dedrick's Cuckoo. Class's Cuckoo. They said they're probably not going to move too much this morning. And said they've probably done a good 10 to 15 kilometers overnight. Male lions are capable of doing further than that. They can walk up to 25 kilometers if they need to, but it is unusual. Normally you'll find 5 to 10 kilometers is their general sort of movement. And also it all depends whether they rushing off to chase off invaders, or they're just doing a good scent marking and boundary patrol. They were roaring a lot last night, and that's why we jumped further to the south to try find them. Morning, Karen. Karen's wondering, have there been any other male lions in this area recently apart from the Birmingham Coalition? Karen, there were two Avoca males that snuck through the corner and into Sibambili. They've now gone south. And I heard there were some young males that came onto Inkoro from the Kruger, but way too young to sort of challenge the Birmingham boys. No adult sort of or real challenges to the Birmingham's throne in the last while. But it could change tomorrow. That's the thing. You never know what's going to happen out here in the African bush. Now, you've seen Byron and myself searching around the African bush. There's a third person who's getting moving, and it's Steph on a bushwalk. So let's go see what his plan is for the morning.
Good morning, good morning. Yes, we are live and we are walking across quarantine as we speak. Now, I have been watching the show for the first little bit of this morning, and I am told, or I understand at least anyway, that Byron couldn't find the lions. They're in some big block, and that's exactly what this bushwalk is good at doing, is walking through the middle of big blocks of bush, uncovering whatever's inside there. For those of you who are just joining the show or are new to this show and want to know what are we doing, my name is Stefan Winterwood and I'm a wilderness trails guide. And what we do is we uncover the bush from a different angle. Foot safaris, or safaris on foot and safaris on vehicles, is how people have been exploring Africa for the last 100 years or so. And it's a very, very exciting, very novel way of seeing things from a different aspect, or from seeing things from a different point of view. And also our focus is slightly different. Of course, we don't get as close as what the vehicles can get to all these animals. But it can be a lot more exciting, or can be as exciting. Let me rephrase that. And then also we have an interest in a lot of different things at the ground level, so to speak. And I'm hoping that over the next couple of hours that I can show you some of what interests me and some of these special little attributes. Now, the wind isn't the best for us tracking lions this morning. I must be honest, it's blowing from us into the area where we hope to be tracking these lions into. And while wind is a factor with lion tracking, I don't know, in my experience I have a mixed feeling about wind direction. I'm not against lions knowing that I'm there. It gives them that much more growling distance, at least anyway, before you stumble on some sleeping cats, at least anyway. Now, we are as interactive as what Brent and Byron are, so you're welcome to send through any questions or comments that you have to the bushwalk. You can do that via the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can use the email address questions@wildearth.tv, and we'll try and get through you as much as what is relevant. All right. Now, my world, your music, these handles are unbelievably sort of engineered. Well, good morning to you firstly, and secondly, you've asked if we could find a solifuge. Yes, I can try and find you a solifuge, no problem. We're in that transition period between the nocturnal solifuges, which are admittedly much bigger and much scarier. They go like this big as my hand, to the diurnal daytime solifuges, which are much smaller, much more fast moving, and then also a lot hairier. In actual fact, they wander around here like little balls of hairy lightning. So we're in that transition period between the two. Generally speaking, one is strictly nocturnal, in other words, just nighttime, we see them coming out in proper dark. The other one is strictly diurnal, we see them running around in the heat of the day, midday. So now it's going to be a bit of a challenge, but if we find one, I'll absolutely show it to you. So just keep on watching. That's the secret. These things happen quite quick. Now we are live, same as Brent and Byron, which means that what I'm seeing pretty much a couple of seconds later, depending on where you are on the globe, you are watching. So we don't quite know what's around the corner. We don't quite know what's around the next bush. And for that, we've just got to keep our eye open from time to time. Now, I have been waffling on for quite some time, so I think what we're going to go and do is go and have a look at what Byron's up to, and we'll catch up with you in a little bit.
been looking around and trying to see what we can find, but it's been a little quieter this morning. We're approaching Buffheshoek Dam now. Might be something around the water. But again, it is cool, it is windy, so animals possibly looking for some shelter in the thickets, trying to stay out of the wind. Not even that resident hippo, it appears like it, no. I'm going to stop up on the dam wall. We can scan around and see what we can find. Maybe there's some interesting little birds. Maybe just listen out a little bit. Any signs of animals? Perhaps we hear some elephant breaking branches. As I say that, look what I found, everyone. An elephant off to the right. Have a look, there we go. I heard a little branch break. There it is. Fantastic. Let me see if I can get us a little bit closer. You see, good things come to those with patience, and you stop and listen. Things happen for you in the bush. I'm a strong believer in that. See if we can get a nice view. It looks like just the one. Don't see any others just yet. Can you get him through there? I think that's our best view for the moment. Actually, hold on a second. Hold on a second, Genre, sorry. He's right in the thicket there. He's hiding from us a little bit. I'm just gonna see which way, if he decides to move again. And possibly try and get another view of him. Hang on, maybe down in the dip. It's amazing how these big, massive animals, these elephants, can disappear into a thicket so easily. He's standing right there. As Jandro spotted, there are two of them. There's another one through the back. It's so difficult. Look, standing dead still. You can just see the tusks. Some very, very loud Franklin calling. And that other one's breaking a branch through the back. Can't believe it's so thick through here. Hang on, we'll just we'll sit and wait. Maybe we're lucky and they do decide to come out. Assume, and I can't really see just yet, but I think these are two bulls, two big bulls that are hanging around together, and that's not unusual. The males often move away from the herds, and especially the big dominant males, and what they do is they'll try and find herds while they're moving around. They'll go and feed, and if they pick up on the scent of a herd, they'll go move in and see if there are any females to potentially mate with. And you do get these groups of males that move around together. Usually an older male might be followed by a younger, more inexperienced male, and the older male then teaches the youngster. Oh, look. Oh, this one's pushing over this tree. Wow. so much power. Isn't that incredible? Just to get to some of the branches at the top. So as I was saying, these older males then teach these younger males where to find food and how to be successful and how to find the females. But look at that, these massive, two massive animals hiding in this thicket. And again, this could be linked to the wind. Maybe they've decided it's better to be in the middle of these trees and out of the wind. I wonder if I can't, let me try to go back a little bit. I just want to see if I can't get a better view for you. Maybe if we go back here. But as you can see, it's very, very thick through here. A lot of tamboti trees around here.
Charging off to the western area, western edge. I've heard a report of an animal that would make me leave almost all animals. I wonder who knows what it is. Of course you do. Apparently there's a pack of wild dogs on their way towards Djuma, and I'm trying to get in the right area to be there when they cross, because we all know how fast wild dogs are, and we don't want to miss them. My favorite animal in the African bush, the African wild dog, or painted dog, or painted wolf. So much of excitement. So apparently they might come out around Impala Plains. So I'm going to get onto Triple M there and just move up and down, waiting for them to cross. Try and make sure we're in the right spot when they do. That are not getting mobile, or is it going to be some of the dispersal packs we've been seeing? The three members of the Lower Sabi, or the three members of the Ngala pack originally. I am fascinated to find out. Change their mind and go south. They must keep coming north, north, north. We want all the animals to come north when we're in the south and west, and when we're on the northern boundary, we want everyone to come south. So it all just depends on where you are. And I'm sure sure a lot of the people on the other side of Gari Main are saying go south, 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 or go east, I mean, not east, whoopsie, that's a big bump, that's a new one. West, west, west. Some very big bumps here now. They obviously heard I was coming this way for wild dogs and quickly made some bumps. Okay, now we're in the right neck of the woods. If the last report I heard was correct, that they would be coming from around the Red Dam area. Oh, but there's a big herd of impalas. Let's see if there are any babies. There was some dispute about my spiral horned antelope quiz. Let's see. They're saying, don't impala have spiral horns? There's a male here. We're going to have a look at it right now. Where'd he go? And the answer is they do not. They have ribbed horns, so they do go outward and inward. Where are they now? Where's the male gone? Oh, there he is. And you see how they go out and in, but they've got ribs, circular ribs around them, and not spiraled. No babies in this herd just yet. Now, the biggest danger to baby impala out of all the animals in the African bush is wild dogs. I've seen them kill 9 baby impala in the space of 20 minutes, each wild dog having its own baby. So while we're sitting here, I'm just listening to the radio, trying to get an update on where those dogs are. Now, in theory, if they kept heading in the direction they were, they should come almost right through the middle of this herd of impala, which could cause absolute pandemonium. Okay, I'm just going to be on the radio for a second. Morning stations in the west, can I have an update for Safari, please? Thought I was on high enough ground to get that radio to work. Alas, no one is replying. Oh, there we go. Is that a reply? In broken static. Oh, look at that. You can see that sideways chewing ruminant. Oh, let's give ourselves a bit of a groom. Got an itchy spot. Okay, well, I'm going to try and figure out what's going on the radio while I do that. Byron has got some great big grey pachyderms.
And this big... He stopped and he just watched us. We are quite close to him. He stopped to watch us, but... looks like he's relaxed again, and we might be lucky, he might cross the road in front of us. magnificent animals. I love watching these big elephant bulls and spending time with them. I don't want to move the vehicle too much now because we are fairly close to him, and he didn't show any signs of aggression, but he did lift his head a little bit and just look at us. And there are little signs that you do need to look out for. Something like that just shows that he's not completely comfortable. But now the fact that he's started to feed again is a good sign. And I always say a feeding elephant is a happy elephant. If they stop feeding and they're watching you, then you know they're not that happy with you being around. Hang on, here he comes. Here he comes. That's it. Come out in front of us, please. He's deciding to take the road. I will move forward a little bit. Let's have a look at him. And there's still another one in the bushes behind us. You can't see him at all. See just how that elephant stopped and he's turned and he's peering at us. But watch out that. And Lynn, it was, look at that. Wow. Look at the power, everybody. Wow, isn't that amazing? And Lynn, you were saying, and you're watching via Periscope, and you say, isn't that amazing camouflage for such a large animal? And it is indeed. Definitely. They can easily disappear through the thicket or into the bushes. And this big bull just pushed that tree over just to get to the leaves at the top. Probably a bit tastier for him. As I was saying, there is still another bull behind us, but in through the bushes, we actually can't see him from where we are sitting now. I can just hear the odd branch break now and then from him also feeding. Oh, look at those tusks, beautiful. There are two very large bulls that we found here. Okay, I think I'd like to sit with these elephants a little bit longer, just see what they get up to and see if that other big bull comes out. And while we do that and see if we get you a better view, let's head over to the bushwalk to Steph and see what he's got.
So we have arrived in the area where Byron last had those lion tracks, which is around about the Sandy Patch, Old Breeze Road area. Now we've just been sitting for the last couple of minutes while you've been with those elephants, just listening to the bush around us. It's quite important that when you don't know where lions are or you don't know where an animal is, quite often you just have to sit still, and rather than manically running around, you just have to listen and feel the bush a little bit and it'll tell you some stuff. And right off the bat, it was about 30 or 40 seconds ago, a noise happened into this bush here in front of us. Inside there, it sounded like a sneeze. Could have been something bumping against another thing. I mean, there's any variety of animals out here that could make a noise like that. Zebra sneeze quite often. Giraffe make weird noises, all variety of weird noises. Elephant, rhinoceros, and buffalo. Doesn't have to just be a lion. But since we're looking for lions in this area, and there's this weird noise, it does warrant a little bit of an inspection. But as I promised, I want to show you something that has been a mystery to me this particular season, going from the dry season into the wet season. It's something that I don't really have an answer for, but I'd really like to share it with you. As some of you might know, I really enjoy ants. And this is a little species of granivorous ant. And what that means is that I've seen them eating the grains of seeds off of grasses. But they are also as far as I can see, they also are carnivorous. You can have a look. You'll see that they are dragging the body of another ant, and it's definitely not the same species. Here we have it again. Now, what has perplexed me is not the fact that these ants eat both grains and meat. It's the fact that they cement with a glue the entrance to their burrows. And it is a very hard calcrete substance. I'm going to show you here. I've just cleared the entrance to their burrow there. You can see that this is eroding away, but this isn't. And it's because that entrance to that hole is as hard as a piece of cement. And the only reason that I can think of that it is like that is as a flood and erosion deterrent. So some ants thatch the entrance to their burrows, and that stops water from going into their burrow, and it stops the lip of the entrance burrow eroding inside, which of course takes time to clear. These ants, I think, create these cement tunnels on the outside edge of their nests for exactly the same reason. Water will come along and erode next to their entrance burrow, the sand, creating a little bit of height, and the water will then flow around the burrow and flow away from the burrow rather than flowing into the burrow. And it's the only thing that I can think of that why they would cement and glue the entrance to their tunnels. That is literally, it'll wear away my fingernail if I scratch it away. I mean, I'll eventually break it down, of course, but it is much harder than the softer sand around it. I don't know what species of ant these are. There's very, very few good resources for being able to identify ants. There are more common ants, of course, are in all our insect books, but this is not a common ant at all. It's a common ant here, but it's not something that I've seen commonly around. They've done particularly well this year, and it's just because there's been so little grass cover that I've actually been able to see their entrance burrows that I was actually able to observe these ants for the first time in about 17 or 18 years of walking around here in the Kruger National Park. Exciting, eh? All right. Now, we have been listening here for long enough, and I think it's a good idea that we follow this game path. You can see it going through the bush over here. Lion, like most other animals, quite enjoy walking on pathways like this, and it's always a good place to start looking for footprints, is right here on these paths, either crossing over the paths or walking on them. At some point, if lions are in the area, they absolutely will walk here. So, keeping our eyes peeled for any sort of signs and markings. So, Paul, you've just remarked on those ants. You've just said, does that mean that the ants are omnivores? Yes, it does mean that the ants are omnivores, meaning that they eat a variety of different food sources. Those particular ants eat anything from grain that I've seen, and at the entrance burrows, when it was summer, they'd throw the husks of their grain, the outside covering of the grain, about a hand span from the entrance to their burrows in this arc. But I have also seen them eating snails. I've seen the discarded husks of the single-banded snail around the entrance to their burrows. And as you just witnessed there, they definitely are cannibalistic on other ant species as well. They definitely were drawing to the burrow entrances other ants. And that's not uncommon. Ants are quite, Catholic in their diets, in that they will eat virtually anything that they can get their jaws into. You do get specialists, of course, but these particular ants look like they're generalists, and it's probably why they're doing so well in this area. Now, we are going to send you over to Byron, who I'm told has some elephant for you.
And we are still sitting with this beautiful big bull just off to the side. I've moved a little bit closer. He's still very relaxed and feeding. Look at those beautiful eyes. Rich amber color. If you do have a closer look, and look at those long eyelashes too. Isn't that incredible? That is beautiful. That is very, very beautiful. Texture of the skin and everything. You can see there's a bit of mud that is caked around his forehead and the back of his head. And that's probably just from dust bathe. Listen. Did you hear that? That was an elephant communicating, just a low frequency vocalization, possibly communicating with the other bull that wasn't too far. Don't know where that other bull is now. And there was one out around here earlier. I haven't heard him again. He's possibly still through the thicket, or maybe he's moved off a little bit. But it's wonderful to get so close to this beautiful male right here. Have him call like that. Let's see what he does. Hoping he moves out into the open a little bit more. This elephant's been a little bit shy this morning. He's been hiding in the thickets or behind trees. Mike, you mentioned that the female elephants in India don't have tusks. You wanted to know if African elephants, if the females have tusks. They do indeed. Now, Mike, I'm just. There's a big elephant coming down the road towards us. Let's just see, there he is. Hello. Isn't that wonderful? There is the other one. So he snuck around very, very quietly through the branch, through the trees, and just come to join this other bull, and now they're moving off together. Isn't that a lovely sighting? So, Mike, as I was saying, getting back to your question, occasionally you can have elephants, perhaps the tusks have broken off, and once they have broken off, they don't grow back. But also I have seen elephants where the tusks actually do not grow out. That could just be a genetic thing that they, or genetic reason that perhaps the tusks have not grown out for some reason, I'm not sure why. But it can happen at times, and I have seen elephants without tusks. But generally speaking, all the elephants in Africa, especially, they do have tusks that do grow out. And you do get the odd exception where you don't see any tusks on an elephant. So I wonder if that doesn't happen with some of the Indian elephants too. But I'm not sure. Like I said, I don't know much about the Indian elephant in terms of their tusks and who. in southern Africa. Well, this has been a really, really great surprise to spend time with these two big bulls. I'm going to move forward a little bit, just see if we get another view of that one male. The other one has moved off. See if we get another view of this male and then possibly leave them. Let's just see. It looks like, well, he did push over a branch or tree rather, small tree, just to get to some of the leaves. Ah, there he is. That's a wonderful view. Also some beautiful big tusks on this male. Look how they wrap their trunk around the branches to break them off. They'll also use the tusks to help break the branches. And if you have a look, I wonder if you can see it clearly there. On that left tusk, so his left tusk, the way we look at it, the tusk on the right, just at the tip you can see. Now he's hiding it a little bit from us. Hang on, let's just see if he moves that tusk out again. I'd like to show you something interesting. But, where is it? There. Just, can you see there's a distinct groove in that tusk? It's very interesting. So I'll show you what happens. You see that? And then, so the distinct groove on that left tusk, and then on his right tusk you can see it's quite worn down on the tip there too. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you something shortly once I leave this elephant. We've had a wonderful sighting of them. I think we're going to give them some space, let them enjoy their feeding, and we'll move on from here. But then I do want to show you something interesting about those . Another ear hole for the elephant is in front, and you should see it over there. That's the ear hole, right there. That's the ear hole, so it's in the front of the ear, and that is where it is hiding, just in there. All right, I'm just going to move on from here. What a wonderful sighting with this elephant, and I want to just show you and explain to you what I meant by those tusks and why I wanted to show you that little groove. Just give me a second. So let me just jump out here and show you quickly. So what happens is while the elephants are feeding, they'll take their trunks, as we saw, and they wrap it around the branches and they break the branches. But occasionally with some branches and with a lot of grass, they wrap their trunk around the grass, and what they do is they use their tusk to actually pull the grass. And by pulling the grass or the leaves or the trees and the branches constantly over that same part of the tusk, it actually starts grinding in, and you get that very, very clear groove which we saw on that tusk. So it's incredibly interesting to see how the grass can actually start cutting into the tusk a little bit, and that's obviously years and years of using that tusk to help tear and break grass, and you get these very clear grooves. And then with the right tusk that we saw, it's possibly right tusk dominant. You can sometimes see elephants will choose to use one tusk over the other, and maybe if they're scraping or tearing bark, they'll use that one tusk more often than the other one, and you then see it shaving down or becoming slightly worn down from tearing bark and tearing branches off of trees or using it to dig. So you can see those signs very, very clearly on the tusks. Isn't that interesting? So we're going to continue our way down this road, see what else we can find. It was wonderful to spend time with those elephants. I think let's head back to Steph, who's still on his bushwalk, and see if he's managed to find any more lion tracks.
So
So we're almost certain that those lions were chasing around some more buffalo again last night. I mean, it's not uncharacteristic or anything for these Nkuhuma ladies. After all this time, they've been feasting on nothing but buffalo over the last couple of months. But what gives me that idea and that impression is the fact that there's so many tracks of buffalo heading, all at the same age, heading in the same direction. And I'll see if I can try and find you one, just to show you what I'm talking about. One that's probably a little bit clearer than just a vague impression in the sand. All right, let's carry on walking in this direction. Oh, here we go. So here's a buffalo track. Here we go here. So that is the fresh track of a Cape buffalo. And you can see, relatively big. I mean, I would say that that is probably not the biggest buffalo track I've ever seen, but it is the back foot of a buffalo track, and that means that it is the smaller of the 2 feet. And all of these tracks are heading in this direction, which means that to find these lion, we've got to walk in this direction. But you can see how the vegetation is starting to thicken up over here, and how we are having to walk through with much more caution than what we were doing literally just a few weeks ago. And that's because we've got to take our time to make sure that nothing is lying on the other side of a bush on a carcass. As you'd know, lions can be dangerous when you approach them in an area where their cubs can't get away from. So we know that these lioness have got cubs with them. We know that they're going to be quite defensive over a piece of meat that they have, over a meal. The cubs are not going to be going anywhere because they're on that meal. And so it always is advisory to just move through with caution. So we take a couple of steps to the other side of this thicket. That's how we do it. And then we wait and see what's on the other side of the next thicket. So let's see how we do it. Okay, this tells me something about the relative age or freshness of this, of these tracks. Now, Corey, I'll get to your question now about what are we going to do if an animal does charge us right after I do this. This is a very good sign to give us an indication of how old those buffalo tracks were. This is the buffalo dung from those buffalo that we're running away. You can see it's relatively fresh. It has a skin on top of it, which means that it was probably done at some point early in the evening, yes, last night. And you can see these circular mounds of sand. These are from dung beetles that have already processed this dung. They've already processed the dung into balls, which they have now buried underneath the dung itself. And this tells me that these buffalo were running through here not early this morning, but probably early yesterday evening. It takes some time for buffalo dung to get worked over like this, a good couple of hours at least anyway. So a good couple of hours old already. But it doesn't mean that the lions didn't catch these buffalo. It just means that this particular buffalo tracks that we're seeing are not as fresh as I thought they were. Now, Corey, on to your question about what we would do if a lion charges us. Now, although it's incredibly scary when an animal decides to shout at you out of the bush, and if that animal feels threatened enough to actually warrant chasing you out of their area, it's just a very clear message to say, please just give us some space. It's a communication that they have with us. It's a very scary communication, and one that you can't mistake for anything else. But essentially, it's just a message. You're way too close to me. I need you to create distance. And so that's what we try and do. What you don't want to do is act submissive. So what we don't want to do is turn your back and run through the bush. That to a lion is just a signal to chase you down. What you want to try and do is go, hey, I see you. So you make a big noise. I see you like this. Please don't come. You can talk whatever. The language that comes out of people's mouths is, in these types of situations, is quite impressive. But you go, hey, I see you, and then immediately, if that animal stops, you create distance. So you walk back, maintaining eye contact with the lion. That's what you want to do. And walking backwards as much as what you can. If that lion comes again at you, hey, you stop, shouted that lion. Generally, they stop. And as soon as you've created, you cross this imaginary line, it's sort of the event horizon basically, which doesn't elicit a charge anymore. You can get to a point where those lions feel that you've moved a sufficient amount of distance not to represent a threat to themselves, their food or their cubs, or their mate in the case of a male lion. And generally they'll just calm down. You know, the aggression sort of de-escalates exponentially after you've crossed that minimum line. And that's similar for most of the animals out here. Elephant, hippopotamus, rhino, buffalo, they're all pretty much the same. They just want you to leave them alone. In some instances though, you can't back away, and that is when you have gotten too close to them. For instance, if a lioness was sleeping on the other side of a bush and her cubs are suckling on her, she didn't hear you coming because of the wind blowing in, you know, too hard in her ears, and you startle that animal from a very close proximity, what will happen is that animal instantaneously in the brain makes a decision. I either need to get out of here to save my life, it's called the flight reflex, or I need to fight. And that is it's an instinctive, instantaneous decision. In that case, it is a difficult thing to say. The outcomes are so varied, and it's so down to the situation and how you react at any given time, but it can end badly. You can be mauled by an animal that makes a decision to fight you. You can harm that animal if you decide to fight back, if we were armed, for instance. But you don't want to get into that situation, and so we try as much as what we can to try and be as quiet as we can in some instances. And in thick bush areas, I like to make a noise so that animals that are in front of us actually know that we're coming and can either move off or growl at us from a relative distance away. So that's that really, Corey. I hope I answered your question over there. I mean, the best thing to say is come over to Africa, come on a walk into something big and scary and see how you feel after the end of that. It is a thing that will change your life forever. It's like being in a car accident, I suppose, or jumping off a bridge with an elastic band tied to your ankle. It's definitely a life-changing experience. Come along. Now, Marie, you've asked me what is the oddest thing that I've ever ventured upon. In the bush while on foot, I suppose, Marie. Well, I'll answer it from the on foot perspective, just because we're walking around here today. Wow. The thing that springs immediately to mind is one of the very first encounters I ever had with lion on foot. I was walking with my tracker and dear friend Mr. Richard Indubani, and we were tracking some lion tracks through the bush on the road. And we were walking on the road, and the tracks of the lions just disappeared. And we were searching about. Now, you can imagine two full-grown men walking around looking like chickens, trying to peck at the floor, looking for signs of these lions. And I looked up at a noise. And probably from about the distance of these trees that you see over here, just this row of trees that you see here, some zebra started to run at us. And in between us and the zebra, this lioness jumped out of the grass, and I'm talking about here, like 6 or 7 feet or yards in front of us, and leapt upon this zebra while we were standing there watching. And next thing, lions just came pouring out of the bush from all around us. At that stage, the pride of lion was 24 lions strong. It was made up of some males, 2 males, some females, I can't remember the exact number, 6 or 7, and the rest were all cubs. And they jumped onto the zebra with me standing right here, and with my tracker standing even closer. Richard was even closer to this action. He was probably 2 or 3 yards away. And they proceeded to ignore us completely and kill the zebra with us standing there watching it on foot. The cubs came out to the kill, and eventually after about 2 or 3 minutes, Richard judged it safe enough to say, "Hey, we can back off now." And we slowly backed away from the scene. And it remains to this day one of the most surreal experiences I've ever had in my life. I was on foot 5 yards or 6 yards away from this zebra being caught by lions. I'd walked into the middle of their hunt, and they were so focused on the hunt, they didn't mind us walking into them. They didn't stand up and growl at us. It was just one of those things that I feel, at least anyway, was one of the most bizarre things that ever happened to me or that I witnessed in the bush. Most definitely. Alright. This is a cat's tail grass, one of the first grasses that come up in the summer, and also a grass that does incredibly well in areas that are a little bit overgrazed or a little bit trampled. This grass enjoys those areas. Now I can see that this grass has got some flowers on it. Have a look close to the stem, you will see this grass has flowers. And believe me when I say that grasses have some of the most beautiful flowers that you can find. They're also one of the most advanced plants in the world. Grasses have only recently evolved, and they come obviously in all shapes and forms and sizes, have taken over most of the world's biomes in terms of biodiversity and mass, biomass. And this is just nice to see those big full pollen heads closest to the middle part of the grass. Now I'm not going to pick this grass and tell you where it gets its name from, but you can see, well, I can show you really. You can see that the grass tail looks like a cat's tail, a bristled cat's tail. And also when it gets wet, it smells a bit like a wet cat as well. It's got this most unpleasant smell when you wet it and you smell it. All right, why don't we go and see what Brent's up to.
Well, welcome back. Unfortunately, that report of wild dogs turned out to be false. Misinformation, but no worries, maybe we'll find our own wild dogs. Now, I've made my way into the area where the Nkuhumas last were. I've seen the tracks are now cutting further to the northwest, so I'm going to head towards Sydney's waterhole. That's probably the closest water from where they were on that buffalo kill, so there's a good chance they're in that area. Now, why VM and I have been gone for so long, we had one of those things that happens quite frequently out here in the African bush. We had to change a tire, but it is changed and we are A for okay, as long as we don't get a second one. A second flat, that is. Okay, so what I'm doing is I'm checking very carefully here, see if the lions haven't meandered further to the west, fingers crossed they haven't gone west or north. We're in a tight little corner of Djuma like this, and very close to boundaries on both sides. But the Nkuhumas haven't been up into this area for quite some time. Now that they're moving again, that's a good sign. Hopefully they're recovering quickly. Maybe that last buffalo there was quite fatty after all. That is not a lion, that is an impala. We'll keep going. Mm-hmm. Now there are some pans around here that hold water, but no tracks heading across the road, so more than likely the lions aren't in there. Oh, well, you never know. There's a big game path coming up ahead. Always a good place to look for tracks. And there are kudu tracks and elephant tracks. And hyena tracks. We've got one more game path to check. Two more, actually. There's one here. Buffalo tracks, and last but certainly not least, the most prominent in the area has been blocked by an elephant. Now, animals, you're just going to have to walk elsewhere. They can see they've come around it here. and let's have a look, just make sure no lion tracks there. They're not. Okay, we're going to keep on our search. While we do that, let's go see what Byron's up to.
We've got a beautiful red-billed oxpecker sitting on a big buffalo. Oh, look at that. Isn't that cool? Look at that big, thick boss. That's that middle structure of horn on this male buffalo. And the males get very thick bosses. You see that oxpecker is just cleaning its beak on there at the moment. The older these buffalo get, the thicker and bigger the bosses get. And that's obviously so they can challenge each other for dominance when they are wanting to mate with females. But these old males often form what we call bachelor herds. Let me just move forward a little bit for you. Hang on. And these bachelor herds can be anywhere between... well, one male by himself, but up to about 10 or 15 sometimes. Possibly find larger bachelor herds. So these old bulls that move around together, and they actually don't move very far. The reason for that is because they are older, they prefer just finding areas where there's some green grass and good vegetation to feed on, and some water, and most likely a mud wallow or two in the area. And what they would do then is they generally stay within those areas. And one reason for the mud wallow is so that they can bathe or roll in the mud. And the reason for that is it helps protect the skin from insects, especially ticks, like that oxpecker would have been looking for, the ticks on the buffalo. So if there is a big herd of buffalo that moves through, and those large herds, somewhere, you know, they can be up to 200 or 300 buffalo moving in an area, especially in this section of Kruger that we are in. I've seen more. I've seen 400 or 500 buffalo moving together before in this area. And that's generally a lot of the females, the younger buffalo, or the calves and that with them, and then some young males or some big dominant males that will move with the herd. But those herds will cover huge distances constantly looking for food and water. So that's why these males, these older males, don't like moving around as much with them. So what they do is they move off into an area where they can stay, hang around, and wait. And if those herds move past again, these males may occasionally meet up for a short while, see if there are any females that they can mate with, try and challenge some of the other bulls around, and then they'll move off again. So they don't. Some people thought that these older bulls get pushed out of the herd. It's not necessarily the case. They usually choose to move off on their own and form these bachelor herds. Occasionally they're called, the other name for these buffalo bulls, known as Dugger Boys. Now the Dugger Boys get the name from that wallowing in mud. And Dugger is a Zulu word, or the word is actually Umdaga, originates from Zulu, and it's a word for mud. So these buffalo bulls would roll around in the mud constantly, so that's where they get the name Dugger Boys from. And these are one of the animals that are probably one of the most unpredictable in the bush. If you are walking and you do come across any buffalo, you do have to be careful, especially these old males, because they can turn and they can come for you fairly quickly if they feel threatened. Generally they do decide to move off, but again, they one of the animals that, as I say, are unpredictable. They'll run a little bit, turn, and they'll come and they'll watch you. And there was an author that wrote interesting, I can't remember his name now, but many years ago, and he wrote, and he said he was a big game hunter, and he said a buffalo always looks at you like you owe him money. And I think that's quite an accurate description of a buffalo. They lift their heads up and they look, kind of stare down their noses at you. And when you get that look, you know you're potentially in for some trouble. They've just moved off now. A lovely view of those two big bulls. I was telling Jandre the other day, we were driving, and I think Dave and I were on the vehicle, came around a corner and there was a buffalo bull not too far from us, and he just looked and wasn't happy and decided to turn and charge. No warning at all, turn and charge the vehicle, which is very unusual. So we quickly had to drive out of there, but it was interesting behavior. And again, it's just that they're unpredictable. That's the biggest thing with buffalo. Thank you. still a very, very cool morning, which is wonderful. It's nice to be out in these cool mornings. I wouldn't be surprised if some of this cloud cover starts burning off a little bit later. That's often what happens out here. Just want to have a look at something here. You know what this is? Not very clear, unfortunately, but I would have liked to have shown you, but these are just little civet tracks walking down the road. Yeah, little civet tracks. Might be able to see them, but they're not that clear. There are civet tracks. Brian, you wanted to know what age would these buffalo move out of the herd? It's difficult to say, Brian. I would say, you know, if generally the average age of a buffalo out in the wild is maybe 15 to 20, the age they can live up to, rather. And I would say maybe if these males get to about 12 to 15, probably decide that it's time to move out and rest a little bit. But yeah, the later years of a buffalo, and like I said, the average age that they can live to is about between 15 and 20 or 21. Some books will say 21 years old, but I think it depends on the conditions in the area. We've got some beautiful antelope over here. There we go. Saminyala. Beautiful female inyala. I don't see a male around here just yet. And there's another one. Look at those beautiful white stripes down the body. That one looks a little bit scruffy though. And it's not actually uncommon to see inyala looking a bit scruffy and ruffled up. I have seen it before on many inyala. They are beautiful antelope, and it's incredible to see how different the males look to the females. Some people think that they're two different species when they first see them, because they do look like it. They look completely different in color. These females with the reddish brown coloration, and the males have that beautiful dark gray coat, also with the white stripes though. And I know Brent was asking this morning, and he put out a quiz for all of you regarding the antelope falling in the Tragelaphus or Tragelaphus genus, and these inyala are in that genus, so they are related to kudu. These animals with the spiral horns and the white stripes or white markings on the body. So nice to see them. And the bushbuck is another one that we get in this area, also part of that family. And Virginia, you wanted to know, do the antelope stay standing when they give birth? I've never seen an antelope give birth, but from my understanding, they do. They do stay standing. They'll try and stand, spread their hindquarters, and give birth that way so that the lamb can drop down. And also with that little thud, it helps just kickstart all the vital organs and that. Occasionally, with the if I look back at giraffe, and when giraffe give birth, there's a long drop for that little foal when it's born. And what happens is, as it drops and hits the ground, it helps just kickstart the heart, make sure it's breathing properly, and also mainly the breathing rather than the heart, but also to snap the umbilical cord. So as it drops, that snaps. And I think it's similar with these antelope, and from what I've heard, like I said, I've never seen an antelope give birth though, but they do give birth standing up, so that the lamb or calf can drop out and maybe snap that umbilical cord, and also help kickstart the breathing a bit. And hopefully also to try and remove some of that placenta that would be around the antelope. Those inyala seem to have moved off. And we're going to do the same now. Let's see what else we can find, and let's head over to Steph on Bushwalk and see what he's got.
We found a very interesting sign to show you today, and it's these two parallel scrapes. Well, we just got Xander stuck. There we go. We are coming to you live from the bush, and Xander does have a backpack on with a big aerial, getting him hung up in branches every now and again. But come and have a look at these two very clear scrapes, parallel scrapes. You got one here, and there's one here. And in the scrape, you can see that there's some dried fluid. It looks like it'd been raining on the top of this scrape. Now, what this is very interesting. It's these scrapings from a bull rhinoceros. It's the territorial marking for a bull rhinoceros. And basically what he did was he came walking through the bush. He saw this little tree here. And then he started to scrape his feet like this. And while he was scraping his feet, he was urinating from between his legs. But they got this like hose pipe like urine. It comes out like a fire hydrant, basically. It's the most intense thing. Probably flattened a bit of this bush. So this rhinoceros came walking like this, scraping the sand and spraying out behind him. And he sprayed out onto the sand. And that's what we're seeing. He was walking in this direction, and the reason why I know that is because here's all the scraped up grass and leaf from his scrapings of his feet. So he was going in this direction. But what's interesting about this is also the fact that if you rub a piece of bark or a stick into this urine and you smell it, it is the most pungent smell. It's quite difficult to explain, but I'm gonna try. It sort of tickles the inside of your nose right in the beginning, and then whacks you at the back of your throat with this mustiness, I would say. This sort of spicy mustiness, a peppery, spicy mustiness. And that's what rhinoceros urine smells like. Why it's still here after all this time is quite an interesting story as well. And the fact that animals that use their urine and other various types of glands to mark their territory have elements in this urine and elements in these glandular secretions that keep that smell there for a long time. Obviously, my sense of smell is very poor in comparison to a rhinoceros's and many other animals that use it as well. But I can still smell this probably days after it was deposited here. And it's interesting in that humans have now evolved a way to utilize this stickiness of smell. Ambergris is a very common use for the lining of a sperm whale's stomach. Is this incredibly pungent substance called ambergris, and that used to be harvested from sperm whales when they were hunted years ago, hopefully more than a century ago, for this ambergris. And diluted down to form the base, the stickiness in perfumes. And that was one of the most common of the uses for this animal exuvate, I suppose, was this stickiness diluted down. While quite pungent in its normal natural form, diluted down forms the stickiness that we find in perfumes. On a more local scale, you find things like civet, where we get our civet from, the African civet. Their anal gland has a secretion that is incredibly pungent and sticky, and that diluted down formed the base of perfumes, and in some areas still forms the base of perfumes. That earth note, or the undertone, that perfume note that carries with you for the rest of the day, that's made of these things. Nowadays, of course, it's all copied and I suppose synthesized chemical variants of these types of things. But isn't that incredible, hey? Oh, it is the most amazing thing. I wouldn't call it unpleasant, but it definitely is very, very, it stays with you a bit. Now, James, you've asked me what is the easiest way to tell the sex of a rhino. It's actually a good question, James, and it's a good question because it's not immediately apparent on the external features of a rhino what the sex is. They both have the same amount of horns. They are different subtly, though. Obviously, the male rhino, when compared to the female rhino, is much smaller. So female rhinoceros are much smaller than the male compatriots, and generally females always are attended by youngsters, so they have quite a good birth rate. So males are solitary, females are attended by youngsters. So if you're looking at them through the bush, that'll be a telltale sign. Other external features is that the female from behind has got a spread pelvis, and her private parts, for lack of a better word, are much easier visible than a male's, who's got quite a compacted bottom. You can't really see a penile sheath on a rhinoceros. They keep everything inside. It's an internal thing with a little bit of skin on the outside. That's about it. And then obviously a male rhinoceros does what we've just examined here on the floor. He will walk and mark his territory quite vigorously. Other than that, James, you know, there's not much to tell a female rhino from a male rhino. It's just relatively, I suppose the easiest one is their relative general impression of size and shape relative to one another. That's about the easiest way to tell the sexes of a rhino from far away, you know, without getting too close. Let's take a walk. Oh, before we go, Anna wants to know, how old is this rhino marking? Well, Anna, I would say that judging from the fact that this grass has already stood up here, this is bone dry. The actual urine mark is bone dry. And the grasses that he did kick up here have already dried up. You can see there, have already dried compared to this grass here. I would say that this is a couple of days old. Probably, judging about the wind that we had here, I would say that this was probably done on Friday or Saturday last week that this was laid down here. That would be my guess. All right, so what we're gonna do now is send you over to one of the others and see what they're up to.
And we've got some more Nyala and an Impala at the back there, but there is a beautiful big male Nyala. There he is. Now you can see the difference between the male. There's another youngster. You can see the color variation now nicely with that young male at the back and this adult male in front. You see how the youngsters, the young males, they will, when they are born and when they are young, are the same color as the females. And the older they get, they start to change color. And you get these beautiful gray antelope as a big male. You see he's doing a bit of horn thrashing there. That's just territorial displays that the male antelope do occasionally. Isn't he magnificent? Beautiful, beautiful big male. Just to see these different antelope in the same area, to see Impala with some of the Nyala. But look at those white markings on the face. Look how they lift their legs when they walk. They generally browsers, but I think at the moment there's so many green little shoots coming out that they are not quite grazing. There's probably little plants in that they are feeding on there. They may be feeding on some of the grass, but I think it's little flowers and little plants that they can find on the ground that they are feeding on. So that would technically still make them a browser as opposed to a grazer. Grazer only feeds on grass. And Nyala tend to feed off leaves, off plants. I can't see what it looks like. I don't know. Don't know what he's got there. But he's enjoying it, that's for sure. Very peaceful at the moment. There's a lilac-breasted roller sitting somewhere around here. I can just hear it, the harsh call of the roller. Oh, you've got some dwarf mongoose there. Oh, look at that. All spotted genre. Isn't that wonderful, everyone? You see what happens when you're just patient, sit around and spend some time with animals. Things start happening around you. Look at that. So cute. Little dwarf mongoose. Now, they're very gregarious, which means they do live in large family groups or large groups. And they're probably, that was probably their home inside that little sandy section. Most likely some little burrows. And look at them. Oh, they are wonderful little creatures. The dwarf mongoose. Smallest mongoose species we get here. Oh, there's a young one. Look at that. We do have many other mongoose species around here too. We also get the banded mongoose, which is also very gregarious. And some of these groups, these family groups, you can have or anywhere between, anywhere between 15 and 30 or 40 of them sometimes in some of the large banded mongoose families. The dwarf mongoose, maybe between 15 and 20 or so in large groups. And then we also have the slender mongoose, the yellow mongoose. Those are solitary. We do see them around occasionally. Also have white-tailed mongoose, the nocturnal mongoose, which is the largest species we get in the area. But those you generally see at night. Funny, you just get a flash of mongoose running through the back occasionally. You see that? There they are, they between those two antelope, and off they go. This is really lovely. Anthony, you said those mongoose are so fast. They are incredibly fast. They have to be. These little creatures need to rely on their speed and agility to evade predators. I just saw a cuckoo flying, everybody. I'm trying to see if it's going to sit. And I think it was a great spotted cuckoo. I can hear it. I wonder if it's still flying around. It's just moved ahead of us. Why don't we see? Let's leave the Zinyala and dwarf mongoose to continue feeding. Let's see if we can find that cuckoo. It's just up ahead. I can hear it calling. That would be a nice bird to see. I think I see it. Up at the top of that tree. Is that not it sitting there? It is indeed. Great spotted cuckoo. Right at the top of the tree. There we go. Nice surprise. I heard you calling and saw it just fly through or fly past us while we were sitting with those Zinyala. That's a lovely bird to add to your list. Any birders who are watching? Listen to it calling. Beautiful, beautiful bird. And it's great to see these cuckoos. So these cuckoos obviously all migrate and they come back for the summer. And it's wonderful to see them because they are very secretive birds and you don't often see them. And so you hear them a lot. They've all got beautiful calls, and you can easily identify them by their different calls, but you don't always see them. And there it goes. Wonderful, isn't that a nice surprise? All right, we're gonna continue on our drive and see what else we can find. Let's head over to Brent, who's got some wildebeest.
Well, unfortunately, our tracking of the Nkuhumas has led us to some wildebeest. They've crossed into Buffheshoek, but apparently the tracks might be coming back towards Djuma again. I'm going to go have a look a little bit further, but I thought we would enjoy a nice herd of wildies. Some of those females are looking quite pregnant, so I think it's going to be probably a week or so before we see the first baby wildebeest. Now, of course, Vim's nickname is the wildebeest, and is that why is that, Vim?
Because of these things.
Because of those things, yes. What Veer meant to say, it's because he filmed the first ever live birth of a wildebeest last year or the year before.
Safari Live.
Safari Live first. Not the very first, yes, Veer. Veer being very particular, as he is. Snorting. What are you snorting at, Wildebeest? Are you snorting at us or are you snorting at something else? Or are you just snorting to get the botfly larvae out of your nostrils? So there is a specific species of botfly that does live inside wildebeest nostrils or sinuses. And that's why they do snort quite often. Such a strange looking antelope, the wildebeest. Sometimes referred to as the clowns of the bushveld. Yes, you're a clown. Certainly look like one. So even though they look like a little bit like buffalo or cattle, they are not, they are an antelope. A very fussy eater. And they like the short grasses. And they'll move vast distances, as you know from the Serengeti Mara migration, to find those grasses. They do have local migrations here in South Africa, but nothing quite to the extent. Also referred to as the brindled gnu. Gnu from the sound it makes when they're chatting to each other. They go gnu, 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 gnu. And the brindling you can see on the neck, the sort of darker and lighter colorations. And one in the middle is the bull, the dominant bull from this area. You can see his horns are slightly bigger and more developed. And there's a yearling giving himself a scratch. So that was a baby last year. He's done well to survive. Hello, ladybugs and daisies. Ladybugs and daisies, what a wonderful name. Is wondering, have we seen Gnomeless Gnomon the Gnu recently? We did. Unfortunately, we were having some tech difficulties, but Gnomeless is still dominating the southern plains of Cheetah Plains, keeping Normal Norman, his northern arch rival, at bay. Let's leave the wildebeests and go see if the Nkuhumas have crossed back towards us. Kristen says, thank you, Vim. The first day ever watching Safari Live was the 20th of November 2014, and there were two wildebeests filmed being born that day. Did you film both, Vim, or?
Bryon
filmed the other one. How then did you become the wildebeest and Bryon just stayed as Bryon?
He got eaten.
Oh yes, Bryon got eaten, or Bryon's mom got eaten. Well, everyone gets eaten eventually out here, but for those of you who might be new, so there was a wildebeest with a very deformed horn that gave birth to a young wildebeest that everyone named Bryon, after Bryon Djuba, the thumb. And of course, because the female was so noticeable and she had a very distinct deformity on her horn, she became known as Bryon's mother, or Bryon's mom. Firstly, Bryon got eaten, I think, quite soon after he was born. Hey, Vim, I wasn't here yet. Yes, a day.
No, like a week or two.
A week or two after he was born, Bryon got eaten. Poor Bryon. And then, when was it? Probably middle of, oh no, early last year, Brian's mother got eaten. We actually, I don't know where I put them, but we did have Brian's mom's horns somewhere. Must be on top of the carports, I think. Okay, now, the Nkuhumas apparently crossed around here, and be turning back. Adam has asked a very interesting question. Why do you see wildebeest walking in circles? Well, Annemarie, it depends on what type of circle. If they're walking a very tight circle and constantly doing that, that's a botfly infestation that's severed their optic nerve. Mostly, I would say, when wildebeest are walking tight circles, it's almost always going to be a botfly problem. But in big circles, I'm not sure. They are known as the clowns of the bushveld, Marie. Oh dear, popped my earpiece out. Let me just put that back in. So apparently the wildebeest, the Nkuhumas, last tracks, were heading east along here towards a large inkaya tree, which is a large knobthorn tree. So we're just checking slowly. Well, there's Rexon. See if he's got an update for us. Nothing.
Lions.
They're flying lions. Ish, giving us a hard time this morning. Yeah, I think they're still inside Buffheshoek. Okay, well, good luck. Hi, Bree. Bree is wondering, why are the lions not eating wildebeest and zebra and impala and stuff and keep eating buffalo? Well, the buffalo have been hit very hard by the drought, which makes them very easy to catch. That's why they've been focusing on the buffalo. Now, we're pretty sure it doesn't look like they've come back out, so they're still in Buffheshoek. They're quite close to the boundary. Nice cool day like today. Fingers crossed they come back sometime during the day. Now we're going to start meandering down towards quarantine, see if we can find that baby impala we saw yesterday, or maybe find two baby impala. Hopefully that baby impala has made it through the night and no predator has caught it. Now we're going to freewheel down the hill. Well, there's some of you new viewers who are pondering, are we really live? Bayou, I'm talking to you. Of course we're live, and Bayou, please send us questions. And if you're not sure, oh, you've sent us a question, but the best way to get a question, because I know, I think you're watching on YouTube, is to use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or send us an email, questions@wildearth.tv, and Bayou, we will do our best to answer them for you. Okay, so we are now heading back down towards Djuma itself. Oh, I can hear people talking on the game drive radio, which I turn down. Let's listen. Oh, that's very loud. Just turn it down again. Nothing important. Let's carry on. What else is out here? I don't know. As I said, we have been issued with flood warnings for this area starting on on Thursday or Friday throughout the weekend. Apparently on Saturday itself, not far, Hoedspruit, not far from here, is predicted to get 120 millimeters. That is an exorbitant amount of rain. And that would be flood weather. As I said, we might be swimming around Djuma if that happens. And if it does happen, let's hope it's a long soaking rain and not a deluge in an hour. That'll wash away all the topsoil. Ryan, now with a downpour expected for the weekend, Ryan's wondering, is there any particular wildlife we're only going to see during the downpour? During and maybe just after, a lot of different frog species, quite occasionally, especially after a big downpour, if the sun comes out, or even if it doesn't, but you've got a good chance of seeing certain snake species. So especially the burrowing snakes, what happens is their homes get flooded and they have to pop out onto the surface. So during rain you can see quite a few snakes. And what else? Who knows, maybe the deluge is going to flush our first porcupine out of a hole. We'll have to wait and see. As I said, I will only tell you it's raining when it's raining. I'm not sure. The weather is a fickle mistress, and every time you try to predict her, she generally proves you wrong. Now, another thing that might get flushed out of their holes during the rain is a stinging eight-legged creature, but we don't need them to be flushed out because we've got Stefan on foot who can find them all by himself.
For signs of their youngsters. So here's the scorpion here, underneath. Now scorpions, even though they have been on the face of the planet for some 300 million years or so, have evolved parental care. Isn't that an interesting fact? So this particular scorpion here, so uncover her there, she'll wait in an area for her babies her young to hatch from eggs. They then climb onto her back and they piggyback a ride with her. She helps feed them until they have molted 5 times. And then from there, they go off on their own. Isn't that an exciting fact? So scorpions make very good moms, at least for their youngsters. This here is one of the more common of the venomous scorpions that we find in this particular area, the olive thick-tailed scorpion. You can see that olive color of the legs there and there, that's the pincers. There's the legs down the side of the body. You can see that olive color. Now, although these things look quite small, I mean, they generally are, I'm gonna put my finger nearby, they can sting incredibly quick. So I'm not gonna put my finger too close, but there you can see a size comparison, that's my forefinger. This particular species of scorpion is responsible for the most stings in the area. And it's because they frequent pieces of wood that people in the area use for firewood. And so when you pick them up, quite often your finger brushes them and they can sting you on your finger repeatedly. It is intensely painful. It's not really that dangerous to adults. Young kids, I suppose, or heart conditions, something like that, can have a negative reaction to this particular venom. And then, of course, anyone who's allergic to bee stings needs to watch out for anaphylactic shock that can result from being stung by a scorpion, which can have a whole variety of different side effects. And of course, what you want to try and do is monitor these things incredibly carefully. Now, I want to see if I can show you if this is a female or a male. How you tell, apart from the fact that if the female had babies on her back, of course, is by the pincers. Males tend to have longer pincers. There you go. Look at that. Immediately on the defensive. And have a look at that long pincer. I would say that this is a male olive thick-tailed scorpion. Isn't that just amazing? The bright color comes from the fact that I think that the scorpion has probably just shed its skin. When their skin, they have an exoskeleton made of a substance called chitin, and chitin doesn't expand. Chitin is how the scorpion gets those parts of the chitin to control skin, and they have a new skin. And when their skin comes, after these most gorgeous colors, and their colors are nice and vibrant and clear. Oh, she is a beauty. Or he is a beauty, I should say. Now, you can see the thickness of the tail relative to the robustness of the pincers is what makes this identifiable as a scorpion you should watch out for. So when you're looking at scorpions, if you ever have the pleasure of seeing scorpions again, what you need to do is look at the relative thickness and design of the tail compared to the pincers on the same scorpion. You can quite clearly see that this tail is very well developed, quite a muscular looking tail almost, and the pincers are quite fine and delicate. If it were the other way around, if the pincers were quite robustly designed and quite muscular looking, and the tail was long and skinny, then you'd know that that scorpion was probably not that venomous, that it used its pincers rather than using its venom. This scorpion obviously uses its venom to subdue its prey rather than overpowering it with the pincers. Very, very nice. All right, Brent has got a woodland kingfisher to show you, and before it flies away, off you go.
Here we go, another woodlands. They're starting to call quite prolifically. I've seen about seven or... There we go, on cue, good boy. As I said, that we're starting to hear them calling quite prolifically, so really, really awesome to have them back. And off we go. Oh, no, there's another one. Well spotted, VM. Can't really make, or you can see the blue, but it isn't quite that electric blue that we see when they are in shining sunlight, so hopefully that'll be happening quite shortly. Now we've come down to the area where we saw the first baby impala yesterday. No sign of baby impala just yet, but we shall be searching, and we'll try catch up with one of those big herds from quarantine. So let's have a look. Oh, hello Ali in New York. Now, Ali would like to know, do any of the animals follow a birthing season? Yes, a few of them. A lot of animals will give birth throughout the year, with peaks depending. Now, the impala, wildebeest, and zebra are very seasonal breeders. So from normally around the 10th or 15th of November, it's a little bit late this year, through to January, they will give birth. So we've seen the first baby impala yesterday. I'm looking for it right now. Oh, naughty elephants. And we are hoping that we're going to see quite a few more. And baby impala are awesome. They're very playful. But I think wildebeest, I'd say in the next 10 days or so, we should see the first baby wildebeest and the first baby pigs, the baby warthogs. They are the cutest. I think that's one of the things I look forward to the most with the coming of the rainy season. Oh, there's a herd of impala. Let's get a bit closer. Could this be the herd that is sporting the youngster, or maybe more than one youngster overnight? Now, there's a bit of an old wives' tale that impalas can hold out their birthing for the rain, and it was often said, but it's been turned out to be complete and utter tripe. So they give birth when they're due to give birth. They can't stop the development of a fetus to wait for decent rains. So I know that's one of those old wives' tales that's done its round in the safari industry for many years. Okay, well, we're going to keep checking these impala herds. It doesn't look like there are any babies here. So while we do that, let's go back to Byron, who's got another birdie.
And what a beautiful bird it is. A lilac-breasted roller, and I'm so glad Brent got to see another woodland kingfisher. Oh, and I can hear a red-crested coron calling too. We'll see if we can find that shortly. But look at the beautiful colors on this lilac-breasted roller. And I know a lot of viewers and guests of mine that I've had in the past, this is one of their favorite birds. They love seeing it. Oh, beautiful. I reckon there's about 7 different colors on the bird, and let's see what we can count. There's the white, that lilac. Let's quickly head to Brent. He's got something interesting there quickly.
Look at this, it's a black mamba. I know lots of people have been wondering about snakes. It's a big black mamba that's being attacked by starlings. And I just saw the starlings acting strangely. So I stopped to have a look. I said, Vim, I'm sure there's a snake there. And we just saw that mamba rear its head. It's quite a big one. And you can see that coffin-shaped head of the black mamba. Now the snakes are going to start getting moving at the moment. Oh, isn't this awesome? Right out in the open. You can see the starlings there, very unimpressed to have a mamba in the area. They might have a nest close by. And they were dive bombing it. They might try dive bombing again. Look at that. Okay, in comes the starling. I'm just gonna move a bit forward. Well, Kat in Tampa, you were asking for snakes this morning. There we go. A nice big black mamba, probably around 2 meters, maybe even a bit bigger. And just seeing where it's going. Don't want to get too close, don't want to scare it. Is it going down a hole there, Vim? Was that a stick? No, that's indeed the snake. I'm trying to see if it's going down a hole, or it's just, no, it's not, it's coming out the other side. Now it could be hunting for frogs, mice, baby birds, and you can just see those starlings are really upset with its presence. Do I need to move them?
No.
Okay. If we're lucky, we might see it climb a tree. I've lost sight of it. Have you? Still got it, Vim? Let's watch the starlings. They tell us where it is. There you go. It's going to climb the tree. It might go into a hole in the tree, or it might climb the tree. This is spectacular. This is one of the best snake sight. What's the best snake sighting of the wet season so far? Now you see a very square-shaped head. As people say, it looks like a bit like a coffin, and that's why you got to be careful around them. Now, of course, you can see the black mamba is indeed not black at all, but more of a gunmetal grey. Now, the black part comes from the inside of its mouth. It has a black inside of the mouth. Now, black is always a colour of danger in the bush because a lot of animals can only see in black and white. Okay, let's move again. Let's try it around. Just wondering if it's going to go into a crevice in the tree, or is it going to... Oh, there's other birds joining in the mamba beating. Let's just try see what's going on here. Is that it there? Or am I seeing things again? Just right to the, just to the left of the base of the tree there. A little bit more to the left. A little bit more. Nah, it's a stick. Now, Easy, who's a new viewer, is wondering, do snakes drink water? Indeed they do. They do drink water. I think this mamba might have gone into a hole. Let's just try it. As I said, we don't want to get too close. We don't want to scare it away. VM thinks he can see it. Back. There we go. No, we've still got it. We've still got it. That's the tip of the tail. Now you always got to worry, where's the head? And of course they have incredibly powerful neurotoxic venom. You see those starlings mocking it? Now it all depends on how big you are, how dangerous a black mamba is. Of course they are very, very... Oh, look at that! Now snakes in there somewhere. Now, if these birds sense an opportunity where they can pick the snake without being bitten, they will do it. Where's he gone? Or she gone? Well, thank you very much, James Richards. James Richards says, wow, Brent, you've got all the firsts of the season so far. Impala lamb, Woodland's kingfisher, and now a black mamba. Okay, let's have a look. Oof. So upset. I'm just trying to see if I can pick up any movement. I'd say, just judging from how agitated the starlings are, they're still, the snake's still just below them somewhere. See the one there, somewhere there. Okay, let's try and move a little bit again. Might be just taking refuge from the bombardment in that little bit of brush we've got there. We could have gone down a hole. Let's just have a quick closer look. I think he's gone down a hole. What do you think, Vim? We just got to be careful. Mamba is also the fastest moving snake. Fortunately for us, a vehicle is faster. Nope. I think he's gone down a hole. Or she's gone down a hole. Wow, wasn't that wonderful? Now, black mambas, as scary as they are, I'm going to tell you a very funny story that happened to a very, very good friend of mine, and who used to work with me in the bush, and his tracker. So they were on a game drive with lots of guests, and off they go. We're on game drive, we're going looking for lions and leopards, la-di-da-di-da. And often when you're talking, not really watching, you're sort of watching the road sort of out of the corner of your eye, and you're talking to your guests. You've got your tracker sitting up front there to spot things. And I'm not going to mention his name, just we'll keep him anonymous now. My anonymous friend and his anonymous tracker, as they were driving down the road like this, his tracker said, stop, 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 stop. So he stopped and he turned off the car. And his tracker leapt off the front. front of the tracker seat and was gone into the bush. And he had managed to park on the end of a black mamba's tail, a very big one, about 3 meters. And where we worked, there were no doors. And this mamba was lashing around and basically came into his footwell. So he leapt out of the car as well. And now there was a big discussion between him and his tracker on how to move the car off the mamba's tail so it could get away. So eventually they got all the guests off the car, made them sit over there, and they took two sticks, one long stick from there to push on the clutch and another one to put the vehicle into neutral, and it didn't roll, it didn't move. So then they went to the back of the car and they pushed it, and the mamba, happily for the mamba, made a safe escape, and so did my anonymous friend, his anonymous tracker, and the rest of the guests. Now, of course, a lot of you might think I'm telling that story because it was me. If it was me, I would admit to it, I promise. But without my friend's permission to embarrass him in front of thousands, I think I won't. Okay, now, so from... while we continue to search for the first and second and third baby impala of the year, or of the season rather, Steph has got some wonderful little insects to show you.
First, I just have to say what a fantastic, exciting that was. It's not every day that we get to see black mambas out here, one of Africa's most feared snakes. I must say, it's something that we keep our eyes open for here on the bushwalk. Like nothing else. All right, well, you know, we've just come upon an example of one of Mother Nature's most wonderful, you know, examples of her complexity, and it's in this branch. Here we have a gall. This gall was formed by either the gall wasp or a gall midge. And what the wasp does, if it was the wasp, is sting the tree with her ovipositor and inject a growth hormone along with her egg. The tree then develops this gall, and the egg then hatches into the wasp's larva, which then eats the inside of the gall out and then pupates, chews its way out through that little hole that you see over there, and emerges as a full-grown wasp. But that leaves all these galls all over the place, and ants love to populate these trees. The tree itself is host to a variety of different insects, all that are preyed upon by the species of ant that is living inside. And I'm going to try and elicit a response by gently tapping on this particular gall. See if I can blow in there and see if one emerges. But there's a entire family of cocktail ants. There one just came out. Did you see him come out?
Yeah, one came down.
Now, they don't like it when their tree is disturbed, and so what's happening is, in response to me blowing on this, they're probably sending out a few soldiers to say, hey man, what's going on? A tree, in return for its sap that attracts insects which then feed the ants, gets protected from any pests. These ants will not tolerate sap-sucking insects and will mob the sap-sucking insect off of the tree, thus providing the tree with some protection. But isn't that already such an amazingly complex story? You got the gall wasp using the wood of the tree as a host for its parasitic, at the time, wasp larvae. The parasitic wasp larvae leaving along this home, which is then in turn inhabited by the cocktail ant, which then protects the tree from pests living on it, and in return for providing the ant with some food in the form of those pests and other insects that are attracted to the tree's sap and to the tree's flowers. Isn't that amazing? The gall on the Terminalia sericea. This is a Terminalia sericea tree, a silver cluster leaf. Now Liz, you've asked me what started my interest in ants, and do I have the same interest in termites? Yes, I actually have the same interest in termites. I just find ants a little bit more interesting than I do termites this year. Every single year out here, Liz, we have a different thing here that grabs my attention. This particular year just seems to be ants. There's just such a huge variety. They're so socially evolved and complex. It's just quite interesting to see them. Termites held my interest and fascination a couple of seasons ago, and they nonetheless just as interesting, to be honest with you. But to me, for sure, ants this year, ants, bees and wasps this year, all from the order of Hymenoptera, have captured my interest. Now, it's come to that part of the day where unfortunately I have to say goodbye to you. We are on our way to breakfast. So I just want to say, on behalf of myself and Xander and Herbert, I just want to say thank you for joining us on this morning's bushwalk. I will catch you again on the bushwalk this afternoon or tomorrow morning at some point in the next couple of days. You'll be seeing me again. Anyway, wherever you are in the world, have a good day. We'll catch up to you later. You're off to Byron.
We've got a beautiful little antelope trying to hide away from us. I'm going to move forward a little bit. It is a tiny steenbok, a little steenbok, a male, and he's been very relaxed. He's been hanging around with us for a while. Let's see if we can get another view of him. Oh dear, there he runs. Now he's decided he's had enough of us. Hang on, he may stop again. Very, very fast little antelope, and look at that. They are beautiful, and it's nice that he's out in the open. Smallest antelope that we have here at the moment, or in this area. Well, it's between this and the little Daker, and I suppose, and the little Klipspringer, but I'm not sure. And I wonder if you've ever seen a Klipspringer on Safari Live. Jandre, do you know if you've... Yeah, there are no rocky outcrops. They prefer rocky areas, so that's probably why. That's why I don't think you have seen one in this area. But we do get them in the Sabi Sands, called a clip springer, or it means rock jumper. Oh, what startled that little steenbok? Gone. Stopped again. Maybe it just heard something and got a little fright. Just shows you how quick and agile they are. If they have to, they'll run very, very quickly to get away from any harm or danger. You could see those little horns clearly on the male. The females do not have horns, so it's easy to tell the difference between the two. Oh, that was nice, a nice little surprise and lovely view of the steenbok. Often they do run away quite quickly, they are very shy. But that little one ended up spending quite some time with us, which is great. Oh, is that a bit of drizzle, I feel, almost. I felt one or two little drops, maybe I'm imagining things. Plum colored starlings. Look at that beautiful plum colored starling. Oh, they just, that one flew off, but still one or two around here. There were three of them. Let's just see where they've gone now. Bruce, you wanted to know, with the rain and that around, do some of the animals then have to move around and do their scent marking again? They are there, you got them there? Here we go. Look at that. Look at those plum colored starlings. Wonderful. Look at that beautiful color. Bruce, just getting back to your question. Yes, the animals like lions and leopards would go and probably do a lot more scent marking after rains, because it does wash away some of their scent. Look at that. Oh, this is great, because I haven't seen these for quite some time. Another one's coming back there. There it is. Three of them. Beautiful. Beautiful. beautiful, beautiful little bird. I just want to read you quickly in terms of their migration, just to give you an idea. And I've got a little bird app, and these bird apps really are fantastic because they've got so much information. But I do find, obviously, it's more important to have a book. But these little apps, if you have a look, you can scan, they give you the distribution. And when they are migrate, when they arrive, what months they are around for. But because these, I think, so it says, you know, they common breeding migrants, so to Southern Africa, and they're present from October through to April. So that's exactly where we are at the moment. So they've, but these little apps will often tell you where they migrate to. So they basically just migrate to Northern Africa, or Sub-Saharan Africa, up to Senegal, Somalia, and then come back through down to Southern Africa for the. But look at the coloration of those birds. So for the summer, for our summer months, they'll come back down. That was a lovely surprise. Nice little bird for those birders out there who want to improve on your bird list. So that was really, really great. Nice little sighting. Well, we've had a wonderful morning. I hope you've all enjoyed it with us too. Nice to see some elephants again, those big bulls that we saw earlier. We'll see you again this afternoon on Drive. I'll probably be on a vehicle again. And from myself and Jandre, thank you very much for being on camera. Goodbye, and we'll head back to Brent and see what he's got before the end of the show. Goodbye, everyone.
We've been searching through those impala herds. Alas, no sign of any new babies. Now, it is fascinating that we got to see that black mamba with its neurotoxic venom. And of course, I told you about the inside of its mouth is how it gets its name. Marco is wondering, how big can a mamba get? The biggest mamba I have ever seen, and it was an expired one, was 4.4 meters. Now, 4.4 meters. Let's go, let's do it next to the vehicle here. Actually, let's go from here. How, can you see my feet, Fem? Okay, so there we go. That's the tail. That's the head. That's the biggest mamba I've ever seen, Marco. 4.4 meters. There are reports of some being over 5 meters. Oopsie, now I'm just going to show you the inside of its mouth. There you go, the black mamba. And see, there should be a nice image of the inside of a mamba mouth. So there we go, there's that black, oopsie, that black coloration of the black mamba. Okay, so you can see quite dark. Now they're front fanged snakes. I was trying to find my ears. Oh dear, making a mess. There we go. So I'm just trying to, there we go. So they're front fanged snakes. As to how old they live, oh, I'm not 100% sure, Mark. I'll double check quickly. But while I'm doing that, I'll just chat a little bit about their teeth. So their teeth, they're front fang snake or new world snake, and basically, which means that their venom glands or venom sacs up, which are up behind their head there, have got in muscles around there. So they're able to control the amount of venom they inject, depending on the size of the prey or whether they're defending themselves. So also, which makes them very different from old world snakes, is that the inside of their inside of their teeth is hollowed. So basically their teeth are very, very sharp little hypodermic needles, and the fact that they can control the amount of venom that they push in is one of the other reasons that they are quite dangerous. But Marco, I'm afraid, I'm not sure, I'm gonna have to find out for you, but they're normally snakes like that are normally quite long lived. I'm not exactly sure how long. I'm gonna have to go research that for you, Marco. and but it has been wonderful. What a great morning. And it's always great when you set out to go track some male lions and you find them, and then everything else on top of that's been a bonus. Woodlands, kingfishers, and of course that wonderful black mamba sighting. So from myself and VM and everyone here at Safari Live, it's been absolutely splendid having you with us, and we will see you shortly for the sunset safari. Hopefully those lions are still around, maybe the Nkuhumas come back, but it's live, so you never know what's gonna happen. See you soon.